Thank you for keeping it urban, and you're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja. Today we are hosting the former leader of opposition and woman MP for Kasese District, the Honorable Winfred Kiza. Honorable, there is a conversation that is going on in Parliament, and this is about increasing the representation of affirmative action in Parliament for women to, is it a third? Because currently, especially, the discussion was around, for example, the special interest groups. For example, youth MPs are saying, why are you only giving us one female MP? Yet, going by the AU charter, which gives us a half, why don't we increase the number to two or three? Don't you think this is going to be an over-representation in terms of affirmative action?
Well, the charter that you are talking about is actually talking about 50-50, the parity. So if we talked in terms of parity, each constituency would have a woman MP and a male MP. So there would cease to be what you are calling affirmative action to that, but we would say there is a woman representative and possibly a male representative, so that we are not talking about a third. We would be talking about the 50-50. If we are having youth from the region, then we'd be having a woman, a female youth from the Western region and a male youth from Western region. Female youth from Northern, male youth from Northern, like that. To me, I feel if we didn't have as many districts as we have, that would have been the best way of representation. Because even currently, you call it affirmative action for the women and for the youth, when the national the female talks about overburdened. Yes, the female youth is overburdened, I can say, because you are the only person in the whole country. The youth in Karamoja want you, the youth in Kisoro want you, the youth in Busia want you, the youth in Iguru want you, the youth in everywhere. This one woman is needed. And people expect this one woman to work like the counterparts, the other MPs, who are just having a few districts. It's unfair. It is the same thing that we have been saying as women MPs. I am in a district, for example, with five constituencies. Now, people expect me to work as much as my counterparts, the males. And they forget that for them, they have a smaller constituency than mine, and yet we are all voted by the same group of people. So somehow, for Uganda, if we hadn't gone too much into the creation of so many districts.
But Honorable, imagine a scenario where you say, for example, you have the youth MPs for the central region, you have a male and a female, and then they you have all the special interest groups represented by women. That means you will have to create affirmative action for the men in the long run.
I'm not so sure that all of them, if the women take them, men, you had them for some time where the women complaining. Men had it. You know, it becomes a problem if it is women having it, but it's not a problem when it is men having it. You see the problem? When we talk about patriarchy, you think it is far from reality. Men will never talk anything as long as
it comes out in speech.
Out in that, their favor. Mm. So men are happy that it is only this one woman who is holding space for the whole country and for them, therefore. So you may call it affirmative action. When you talk about affirmative action, you are looking at someone who is maybe of little energy. You want to give them space to be seen and therefore to help them grow. But you are giving me a bigger task. Really, do you still think I'm of a smaller, I am of little energy? You say we are helping this woman to also be visible and be seen on the platform. But you are giving me a bigger responsibility than the one of the man whom you think is stronger than me. So that I can even tell you that women are stronger than men in doing these things. So even if we said parity, it would be no problem. Rwanda has had it. That is why you see that Rwanda has a bigger number of MPs, women, than men, because other women decide to go for the many seats and they give them. And I can tell you, even if you said Uganda, let's have parity, gender parity, equal representation, maybe you may have more women, or we may even have equal numbers of men and women.
Honorable, you're leaving parliament after 15 years, but yes. You have colleagues that have served for over 30 years. Do you think overstaying on positions, especially on affirmative action, is progressing the agenda for women?
I would say yes, because somehow we also need seasoned politicians who will be there to debate at an equal footing with men. They blame us women for overstaying on the affirmative seat, and yet they will expect us to debate in the same way with men who have overstayed. So if what is the problem with having a few of us remaining around for some time to give backup support to the new ones who keep coming in, and also reasoning at the same level with these other men who have overstayed. As long as there are no term limits, those issues will always come. It will only depend on individuals who choose not to contest again and who choose to quit.
So would you rather wouldn't it be unprecedented to have term limits for MPs?
It should also be there. If we can crave for it for presidents, why don't we also have it for members of parliament? I would say that term limits should be for all elective positions, so that we know that we are taming this appetite of people wanting to stay and stay and stay.
So are you saying those that have overstayed should start thinking about packing their bags?
It's not me who vote them. And it's I don't think for them. Others may say for us we still want our people. It is not about me. Me, I have told you it's a decision I made 4.5 years ago. It is up to them to make their decisions. I am not coming here to say, please pack your bags. It is not me who brought them.
Honorable, all your political moves seem to be attracting a lot of storm and dust. When you were leaving the position of leader for opposition, there seemed to be a lot of acrimony around it. Is it that we parliamentarians are not accustomed to change? Is it society that is not accustomed to change? Why is it that every other political move you make gathers a lot of dust?
That I think should not be for me. Because for me, I move. When I move, it is society that reacts, not me. When the changes for leadership of the opposition came, I moved. And society said, no, I think we still needed her. I don't see why. And you know, somehow I get surprised that the people who said it is okay for change to happen when I was moved from the leadership of the opposition, while the whole world was saying, no, I think she shouldn't have gone at this time, they are now the same people who are saying win is fearing defeat. Does it make sense to you? At that time, they said it is okay, even when the world wants her, she can move and another person takes center stage. And for me, I said it is okay. We need to work together to see that we shape the destiny of our country. Now, when I say I think I need to take leave so that another person comes up and we shape the destiny of our country together, they are saying she's fearing. I see some sense of...
Honorable, our political terrain seems to be now getting used to formation of new political parties. At every turn, you'll have to form a new political party.
I think as a country, people have no idea how political parties are made. Just go across here in Kenya, political parties are not permanent. Political formations come up during elections and you will see things changing. You see this party uniting with this. After the election, they have disbanded that vehicle. So for me, I see no problem with it. If someone chooses to get a vehicle through which to deliver people to State House, what's wrong with that?
Your friend, Honorable Robert Kyagulanyi Ssentamu, has formed his National Unity Platform. Where does that leave you members of traditional or the old political parties that have been hobnobbing with him? You've been making posters.
I told you from the word go that he's a partner in the struggle for change. And I told you that me, I don't underrate anybody coming in whichever fashion to support the struggle for change. Whether he comes under the red beret, or he comes under the blue umbrella, or he comes under the green belt, or what, as long as the destination is change, I welcome him.
Honorable, you say political parties lack the culture of listening to their members and others and the people. How can this culture be changed? Because one of the things that has time and again come up in parliament has been the struggle between the headquarters, head offices of political parties and the leadership in parliament.
I can tell you that our democracy is still a young democracy. And you should know that we spent a long time out of political parties. This time that the NRM disbanded political parties, when the NRM took power and we went into a no-party state, that time disoriented members. When political parties still believe in individual members, you will see it in the NRM. Without Museveni, there is no leader. That's why they will always crave for a sole candidate. You see, in my party, the FDC, they will tell you without Besigye, there is no leader. Maybe in other political parties, it will be the same. The issue is that political parties are also grappling with getting themselves to the reality that people do not understand even political party activities. People still even vote people because of who they are. You may look at an area where maybe a political party head or a political party flag bearer for the presidency will get less votes. And yet the MPs for the same political party will get higher votes. And you keep asking, were these people voting the MPs because they are their sons and they did not vote their president or what? The issue is that we are no longer firm into our political parties. The other issue is that our political parties, apart from giving their members the manifesto and the party simple, members still believe that they struggle on their own. And therefore they believe that they need some respect from their headquarters. Because in a way, they are the sellers of the political parties. So somehow when the headquarters of the political parties want to hold them accountable and want to take them at ransom, members will say, no, 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 please, first look here. Mpozi, how did we get into this? So somehow the issue of individual merit, the issue of adherence to political party guidelines, somehow a member will look back and say, yes, my political party wants this, but what do my members want back home where I'm voted? Because the member is aware that not all those who voted him or her are members of that political party. So creating a balance between the interests of parliament, the interests of the political party, and then the interests of your constituency can be a little bit difficult.
So, Honorable, in your view, do you think multi-party politics is growing? Is it advancing or is it stalling? Because you've highlighted the issue of individualism and cultism in building institutions. And how can that mentality be dismantled?
We have to take time to learn this thing. I'm not saying multipartism is killing everybody. No, we have to take time. Parties will also have to work hard to let their members understand. They need to know that the members have to create a balance. You know, many of the political parties don't have a clear program on ground that, you know, this is what we are going to do. You know, in other developed democracies, people are members of a political party from day one. And they will tell you that family belongs to the Democratic Party. That family belongs to the Conservatives. And you will see the children, the grandchildren, and the other ones, and all the members of the family have been born and groomed and nurtured through the system of that party. But here, you find a family where maybe the husband is this, and the daughters are the other, the sons are the other, and the husband is this. So that mix, we still go. Maybe someone feels likes Winnie, likes the way Winnie does things, and will say, I will belong to Winnie's party. Just because he likes Winnie, has not even gone back to look at the ideology of the party. So when we still have such issues as basis for recruitment in our parties, when Winnie ceases to matter in the politics of that particular party, the members who came because they liked Winnie will tend to go slow. So we need to take time, nurture our people, groom them. Many of the political parties become active when we are going for campaigns. They take all this other period, and the government has been very good in that, ensuring that other political parties do not participate in nurturing and ensuring that they groom their leaders and members for people to appreciate why they are in political parties and why they should participate in all the activities of the political parties and knowing where to go. That is why you will see tear gas at all functions of political parties that are not NRM. Because the sitting government does not want political parties to build themselves. I can even tell you that it's the same with NRM. That's why they will have their members called rebel MPs. You wouldn't be having rebel MPs if we are having a party that believes that even internally you can disagree and continue to work as members of the party.
So if the strongman syndrome is largely manifested in the ruling party, but it is equally reflected in the opposition political parties, which way is it for you?
That's why I'm saying that we shall have to take some time to understand. And that is why you should not even brush off any person who comes up as a political player. When you say, hey, this one is now coming to destabilize this other party. Hey, this one is coming to destabilize this other party. Let's watch people grow. Maybe the space they are creating may be the stable space for them. Maybe that's where they will learn their politics from. And then the only thing we can begin teaching Ugandans is to learn to coexist. Play the politics of for us all. Yes, when we are going to play the politics, let's show people what we are going to bring on table, but bearing in mind that we belong to a particular political party because we believe in its values, we believe in its aspirations, we believe in what the political party does, not necessarily the individuals.
Honorable, there is talk that you're leaving elective politics because you're preparing yourself for a very juicy job in government. How true is this allegation?
I've never been in government, so how do I begin preparing myself for a juicy job in government? I am not in government, and I can't begin preparing to have a sitting room in a home that does not belong to me. So that is just talk. Otherwise, there is no government job that I'm preparing myself for. I don't know which type of job anyway would stop me from seeking re-election. I don't know.
Maybe you're going to be appointed ambassador.
Ambassador? I can see ambassadors leaving ambassadorial jobs coming to be members of parliament. So really, would I leave being a member of parliament because I want to become an ambassador when ambassadors are leaving the stations to come and be MPs? That would be a contradiction of sorts.
Honorable, as we are winding up, any key message for politicians that are due for retirement?
Well, I'll start with number one, the President of the Republic of Uganda. I would tell him it's time for him to also think that he must have nurtured people. People must have seen him play this important role of head of state, fountain of honor. It would be in his interest to sit back and see, can others do it the way I have done it, or they can do it better? Should be in his interest to sit back and possibly play the advisory role to this other member who would take up state power. To me, I would feel that's what he would call success. Mzee Benjamin Mkapa was moving with his head raised high when he saw others who are coming after him doing even much bigger things than he would have done. And therefore, I would say that we can only consider ourselves successful, not by carrying the whole load to ourselves and not imagining that we are the best. We can do it better by empowering others as well.
Honorable, thank you for making it to the show.
Welcome.
You've been watching The Checkpoint, and we've been talking to Honorable Winfred Kiza, woman MP for Kasese Municipality and former leader of the opposition. Be sure to catch The Checkpoint tomorrow, same time. Good night.